Hello everyone. This time we will discuss how to read the rotor angle position on a BLDC motor, the calibration process, and its implementation on STM32. The rotor angle position is very important for obtaining the electrical angle, which will be used in the part transformation and inverse part transformation in the FOC or field-oriented control method. There are various types of sensors and methods for reading the rotor position. However, for this project, I chose to use the AS5047 magnetic encoder. The reasons are that it is relatively affordable, easy to use, and capable of providing accurate angle readings with high resolution. AS5047 is a magnetic encoder capable of reading absolute angular position with a resolution of up to 14 bits. This sensor works by detecting the magnetic field from a diametrical magnet mounted on it at a distance of approximately 0.5 to 3 millimeters. Changes in the magnetic field are then converted into digital angle values. Therefore, the magnet is mounted on the end of the rotor shaft so that the sensor can directly read the actual angle of the rotor. The AS5047 features several communication interfaces, including SPI, ABI, which generates signals similar to an incremental encoder, UVW, which generates signals similar to a Hall sensor in a BLDC motor, and PWM. In this implementation, I chose SPI because I required high-speed absolute angle readings, and SPI allows the use of DMA or direct memory access to accelerate data transfer while reducing CPU load. According to the AS5047 datasheet, to read the angle with the dynamic angle error compensation feature, we must send the data 3FFF to the sensor, and the angle value obtained from the reading will be provided in the next SPI transaction. There are a few things to note. First, each SPI frame must include a parity bit on the 15th bit. Second, for the read command, the 14th bit must be set to 1. By calculating the parity bit for the data 3FFF, we obtain a value of 1. So the final data sent as the command is FFFF. After the data is received from the sensor, the next step is to check the parity bit to ensure data integrity, then check the frame error bit to detect communication errors. If both checks are correct, the data is considered valid and can be processed into the desired angle value. Data encoders usually contain a small amount of noise. To smooth out the readings, we can use an exponential moving average based low-pass filter. This filter is chosen because the process is simple, fast, and requires only a small amount of calculation. This filter has an alpha parameter that determines the weight of new data compared to previous data. A large alpha value makes the filter response faster but less smooth, while a small alpha value produces smoother data but a slower response. We can choose an appropriate alpha value to obtain the desired cutoff frequency. Every time we install an encoder, its zero angle reading is almost never perfectly aligned with the motor's zero axis. This condition is called misalignment. To correct this, we perform offset calibration, that is, adjusting the encoder's reading so that its zero angle mechanically aligns with the motor zero angle. Since we have already learned how to control the motor in open loop mode using SVPWM, we can use this method for the calibration process. First, apply a direct voltage, VD, and an electrical angle position of 0 degrees. Second, when the rotor's magnetic field is locked in this position, read the encoder's angle value. Third, use this value as the offset and subtract it from each encoder reading to obtain the actual rotor angle. However, after correcting the misalignment, our work is not yet complete. Mechanically, the magnet on the encoder may not be installed exactly at the center of the motor shaft. As a result, the encoder readings experience periodic distortion. This is called eccentricity error. This distortion usually takes the form of a sine wave or other harmonics that repeat every full rotation of the rotor. To address this, a common and effective method is to create a lookup table containing compensation values for each angle. To do this, rotate the motor in open loop mode using micro-stepping over a full 360 degrees. At each step, read the electrical angle measured by the encoder. Then calculate the difference between the reference angle we provide to the motor and the actual angle from the encoder. Store this difference in the lookup table array using the mechanical angle of the rotor at that step as the array index. It should be noted that because the rotor moves mechanically, it is possible that not all indices in the lookup table array are filled. This occurs because there is no exact mechanical angle position corresponding to a specific index. To fill in the empty parts, we can use a simple interpolation approach by taking the average of the values before and after. Once the lookup table is fully populated, it can be used every time an angle is read from the encoder. The process involves using the encoder's read angle as an index to retrieve the compensation value from the lookup table, which is then added to the original angle. The result is the corrected rotor angle, which aligns with the stator's intended electrical angle. Once we obtain the precise rotor angle value, this angle can be directly used as the reference angle in the inverse part transform process. Thus, the transform values of V alpha and V beta can be converted into PWM signals using SVPWM. The advantage of this method is that we no longer need to manually adjust the reference angle, as is the case with open loop stepper motors. The rotor angle will automatically follow the actual position of the motor. In a simple experiment, when the reference voltage VQ is still low, the motor can rotate smoothly at low speeds. However, as the voltage VQ is increased, the motor's rotation begins to distort. The cause is the back EMF in the motor, whose magnitude is proportional to the rotor's rotational speed. The faster the motor spins, the larger the back EMF, thereby reducing the effective voltage driving the motor current. This is why we need current control in FOC. What we actually control is not the voltage supplied to the motor, but the current flowing in the motor windings, because it is this current that directly determines the torque produced. In the next episode, we will discuss the implementation of current control in FOC. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.